Nacogdoches Hotline.
Hey, can I connect you with you?
Yeah.
With Johnny?
No problem.
Hello?
It's that, you know, that's funny. I answered the phone, Nacogdoches Hotline, and I didn't know that it was going to be Jackie. You know, in every city in America, there's some weird street name that has a weird spelling or weird pronunciation. I was thinking back to San Antonio going, I was in broadcast school, and some gal, we were doing a pronunciation test, and she pronounced Nacogdoches Nacho Doggies.
Being from San Antonio, that's really funny for me, because... I saw that street many, many times.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Johnny, so great to hear from you, brother. You know, we go way back. You guys were just in Reno a few weeks back. I remember when you guys played at Sidelines over in Sparks, little tiny joint, and of course, your first appearance at Aftershock. Take me back a little bit. Tell me what that time in your career kind of meant for you guys and nothing more.
Yeah, so when Aftershock came around, that's where we met,
yeah.
By the way, right?
Yeah.
Always makes me think of that Eminem song, you know, that you only got one shot.
Yeah.
To not miss your chance to blow. That's what I felt at that festival, because we had been plugging it out for years and years in dive bars, playing to 5 or 10 people sometimes.
Right.
And living off ramen. And and basically that was the festival where we got our shot. And right around that time, almost every label that we knew of in the genre had said no to us. And this, we made the record on our own, and that's when 11-7 entered the picture and started showing interest. Was right before this show, ironically, and then this show just kind of put us on the radar for a lot of people and a lot of business people, and you know, I got to say, you know, you've been there since day one. I consider that day one of like our actual career.
Right.
So you pretty much supported us and believed in us right then. And, you know, I always remember that, and we appreciate it, man. You've been, you know, pushing us right at the beginning there.
Well, you know, Johnny, this is my second day back on the air here in Reno at KDOT at Rock 104.5, and I think we were one of the first stations in the country to play some of some of that stuff from the last album. So, thank you. That means a lot for you to recognize that. Thank you, man. You know, you guys have been on the road supporting the stories we tell ourselves since last Aftershock in October. Tour taking you all over the place, including Europe. And I saw some of the pictures online of your European, we'll call it a vacation. I'm sure it was less than a vacation. Do you have a spot that kind of stands out in your mind in Europe that you went, whoa, this is an incredible place to play?
Yeah, God, there was quite a few. The one that stands out the most was in a country called Estonia.
Uh-huh.
And it's right next to Russia, up closer to the Scandinavian countries.
Okay.
I think it's pretty close to St. Petersburg as well in Russia. So it's up there, tiny little country, and I had to look it up on a map when we got there. I was like, where are we?
Wow.
And sure enough, we played this show with Stone Sour in a medieval era convent. It had no roof on it, but it was this giant rock convent with dungeon-like little tunnels and caverns and rooms with, you know, old, you know, Game of Thrones style, you know, jail bar like doors, and it was pretty insane that we were playing in there. It was like playing inside of a relic. I think it was built in like the 1300s,
wow,
1200s, something like that.
Because I'm sure a lot of venues can kind of build something to duplicate that, but you were in a place that was legit.
Yeah, like as legit as could possibly be, I think, as far as playing inside of something that's, you know, not in a museum already or protected. So that was pretty amazing. And then I will say a close second was playing the Olympic Stadium in Barcelona with the one and only Guns N' Roses.
Man. Okay, so when you play with Guns N' Roses, do you actually have a chance to hang out with Slash and Axl and talk to them?
I did not, unfortunately, but the Duff was side stage, and he was filming, and he spent a friend of ours, also he was our manager at one point years ago, a guy named Danny Wimmer.
Yeah.
He runs a lot of the festivals in the United States and a big player in the rock biz out here. And he sent him a message and said that we were, he said, your boys are killing it on stage. Thanks for, letting us have them out or whatever. Said something really nice, made us feel amazing. And then they asked us to come out again. Unfortunately, the date that they were asking wasn't going to work with our plans. We were going to be on the other side of the world.
Bummer.
But that's good news, though, because that means we might have some Guns N' Roses shows in the future, and then we probably will get to hang out.
Okay, so look, you got to be exhausted with all the travel. Here in Reno, of course, we have the Truckee River. We've got gambling. We have Lake Tahoe, of course. Now, I know you had a day off in town the day before your recent show downtown at Cargo, and I've heard rumors about what you did. It had something to do with the tour bus, but I want to hear it straight from you. What a day off in the world of Johnny Hawkins from Nothing More kind of looks like.
Yeah. Man, it's kind of a sore subject. So I am the resident grump band when it comes to sleep.
Uh-huh.
Because as a singer, I leave all my energy there. And so there's so much, my voice is just trashed.
Yeah.
And the only way to recover is to get, good sleep. That's like my only defense against all those things. So, for whatever reason, this bus that we were on, that we got for, is a great bus. We all love it. Everything about it's awesome, except you can hear every word from people in the front lounge.
Mm-hmm.
If you're sleeping in the bunks, there just isn't any kind of separation with sound. So it kept waking me up when people were having drinks on the bus or inviting people on or, laughing real loud. So I went to Home Depot on my day off and sketched up designs about how to rebuild an entire doorway. And so I built a frame, foam insulated it, bought mass loaded vinyl, which I've used many times. And I've built, a few studios working with the band on the production side. So I knew what to do. I knew what I wanted to do. Got the whole thing built, spent about 10 hours on it. Was exhausted, and then sure enough, the owner of the bus company got a little freaked out, rightfully so, and it turns out that it's illegal. Whatever I built was illegal with the insurance. As far as the design of the bus, like it's a
like a fire hazard.
So I was a bit stubborn, fought back on it, and then ended up just giving in and tearing the thing down, and now I have another solution. So my other day off was spent ordering these sound insulating super thick blankets, and I've basically made a cave around my bunk. So now I'm sleeping in this little fortress, and it seems to be working so far. I've been sleeping well. So good news.
Johnny, you and I go back a lot of years, and that story does not surprise me at all. I remember when you had it was like a box truck or something you guys had retrofitted into a tour bus, and it's all part of the creativity, man. By the way, congratulations on all these Grammy nominations. You got three, one for Best Album, one for Best Rock Performance, and then one for the Best Rock Song with Go to War, which was featured on Planet of the Apes and MMA, right?
Thanks.
How surreal was it to get a Grammy nomination, man?
To be honest, it didn't really hit me at first, or I didn't really feel much emotionally.
Yeah.
It wasn't until I talked to my dad on the phone. We were in Prague when we got the news, and I was walking down the streets after the show that night, and hearing his voice, he's almost 60 now.
Mm-hmm.
And he was there since day one, like the real day one of, buy me a drum set when I was seven.
Sure.
And helping me build the garage out into a rehearsal room when I was, in high school. And so he's really seen it through, and his voice was just, I couldn't get him off the phone. He was just...
Wow, that's cool.
I think that when I heard his voice, that's when I really felt the emotions. Wow, look how far we've come from these little punks in a garage or a kid in my room just staring at a blank white wall, imagining what it would be like.
Yeah, no doubt. You know what? The Grammys have long. I don't know. They've kind of thumbed their nose a bit at rock. They really haven't. It hasn't seemed like the Grammy committee has gotten it. What might fans of rock music be interested to learn about that experience going to the awards ceremony and everything else? Was there anything that was kind of an aha moment for you?
It was way more lopsided than I had hoped, as far as the TV. What the Grammys were, you know, because when we went to go to our award ceremony, it was in a separate venue, and there were amazing musical performers on there that just, like, from all different types of genres, and to me, that was the real Grammys. And then we went to another venue where it was the giant stadium, and it was the popularity contest pop show, you know, which was a whole nother thing. That's when it came more about, you know, bullshit. It was about, they made so many things political. It was pop culture, like, you know, all the that most people in the rock world, like, hate.
Right.
You know, it's what our song Mr. MTV is about. That was the part that I was pretty disappointed on. It was basically the hip-hop awards, which, I actually like certain hip-hop artists. Most of them are a little bit older.
Mm-hmm.
Not so much this generation as much. But I was like, man, come on, I thought this was about music. And to be honest, if it wasn't our first time, I don't know if I would have gone. The fact that it was our first time, and, you know, and our friends are so excited, they're like, you know what, we're going to go, we're going to experience this. But I respected Avenged Sevenfold and some of the other rock bands that didn't even show up. I totally get where they're coming from.
Yeah.
On doing that, too. So, yeah, it was a lot of mixed emotions for a lot of different reasons.
Life on the road, I would imagine, can be a little unhealthy. Do you have a favorite fast food chain? And what do you do to kind of remain, arguably the most fit rock frontman on the planet, aside from trying to get sleep?
Usually fast food becomes my favorite really quick if it's 3 a.m. and I have alcohol in my system. That's when fast food becomes number one in my life. I'm going to say Taco Bell's probably my number one next morning hang.
The new song is called Just Say When. Now, when you played this song here in Reno, you mentioned the song has a very special personal meaning. Can you tell me a little bit about the story behind the song?
Yeah, so I was in a relationship for about 8 years that turned into a marriage. And this was with a girl that I met at the calendar day of my mother's death. So I had said goodbye to my mom. Family was in mourning, went out with some friends because it was a long battle of cancer. So at this point it was almost more of a relief because we had really kind of mourned her going away so long over the course of that last year. And, so I really just went out with friends and pretend like everything was okay for a little bit. And met this girl, and from there we started talking and turned into a relationship. And if we would have met, I think, in a more stable emotional place, the story could have been different. But that led to an 8-year relationship, and at the end of that, I was in this stage the last 2 years where it was basically that in between where it was like lukewarm, and it didn't feel right, but it felt wrong to let go as well. It almost felt like a rock and a hard place. And that's where those lyrics and that feeling came from, because I did let go because I felt it was the right thing to do long term for both of us.
Mm-hmm.
And but it was a painful process because there was a lot of history and a lot of emotions tied into it.
Well, Johnny, I appreciate you being able to put those emotions on paper. A lot of strong men would not be able to divulge their soul like you've done so well throughout the years on all the Nothing More albums, man. And I just appreciate you. You know, I love you like a brother, and I can't wait to see you again. I'm not sure if it's going to be on, you know, this album cycle or next one down the road. But take care of yourself, and thank you so much for giving me a call today, Johnny.
Dude, thank you, Jave. And next time I see you, I would love to get some barbecue. Last time I was in the middle of a project building a door for the whole tour.
I hear you.
We always love the cookouts, man. Look forward to seeing you again.
Hell yeah, brother. All right, be safe on the road. We'll talk soon, okay?
All right, will do.
All right,
thanks,
see you,
Jave.
Man. Bye.
Bye, man.